Good morning, everyone. Good to see each of you here today. Would you stand together? And like we do usually each Sunday, take this opportunity to turn to someone next to you and let them know that you're glad they're here. Meet someone new today. Shake a hand, share a smile, give a hug. Together. We have been called today to worship the Lord, to come together corporately, all in one accord, to sing unto the Lord.
Sing to the King who is coming to reign. Only to Jesus, the Lamb that was slain.
Hosanna, Hosanna,
Cause when we see you, we find strength to face the day. In your presence, all our fears are washed away, washed away.
Worship the Lord. Give him praise today. Amen. Amen. You may be seated.
Amen. Wow. Certainly glad that I'm at church today. I hope that you are too. We want to welcome you here this morning and glad you've chosen to come and worship with us. Look forward to seeing what God has for us today. A few quick announcements to share with you about what's going on in our faith family this week. Obviously, Vacation Bible School begins tonight, 6:30. So if you have a child ages 3 through 6th grade would like to come and participate, we hope that you will invite them and bring your own. If you are volunteering at Vacation Bible School, Miss Amy would like you here tonight at 5:30 for a volunteer meeting. If you'll just show up ready at that time, we'll get you where you need to go, give you our schedule, and answer any questions you might have, and be prepared to receive children around 6:15 tonight. But looking forward to all that God has for our kids. Milo shared a great testimony with us last week about his grandson being saved at Vacation Bible School. I didn't touch anything, and I'm just going to stay right here. So hopefully tonight we will be concerned for those children in our lives who don't yet know Christ. This might be that opportunity. So we hope that you'll come and join us this week, 6:30 each evening. So perhaps you didn't sign up to volunteer and you'd like to just come and hang out with us. We hope that you'll come and do that. We'll also be receiving a Vacation Bible School offering. And this year our offering project is helping hungry children. You see that in your bulletin today. 25 cents will provide a meal for a hungry child. So Beth Berge's going to be sharing our mission moment with our children this week and had a great idea, maybe even right now. So our children will be spending time in the service with us this morning. Perhaps you've got a quarter in your pocket. You can take that quarter out, share that with them, but let them know this is for their Vacation Bible School offering. If you don't have a quarter and you have a dollar or $20 or even $100, you know, you can throw that to them too. That would give 400 meals. Think about that. Well, I mean, just think about their eyes, how big they would be. What a great opportunity that is to just encourage and to teach our children to give and to give back and to help others. So looking forward to all that God has for us this week through Vacation Bible School. Also keep in mind that we have a new session of Grief Share beginning in July. And we have something we haven't asked for prior to this that we're going to need. There's been a request for child care for Grief Share. We have those that would like to come and participate that do have children. And we need to be able to provide nursery care for them. And we're looking for volunteers for 13 weeks on Wednesday evenings to come and help minister to the children so that mom and dad can find help through this grief share process. That'd be something that God would speak to you about and you'd like to get involved. Please come and see myself or see Bob Wilson. Bob, raise your hand for me. Here's Bob. So come and find him. We just know God's speaking to somebody right now about that because he's doing wonderful things through our grief share ministry and he wants that to continue. So hopefully we will respond accordingly and provide that opportunity and need. Men, next Saturday, and real quick, I want to invite you to come join us for our men's prayer breakfast. Be up at the fellowship hall beginning at 8 a.m. I know, 8 a.m. That's pretty hard for me, but we'll be here 8 a.m. ready for breakfast, June 30th, spend some time together fellowshipping and time together in prayer. And if we're not going to be people who pray, then everything else we do is for naught. It's not going to matter. So men, we're going to take up the reins and be who God is calling us to be men of prayer. And we look forward to seeing all that God has for us. Finally, and then I'll shut up and we can continue to worship. We have 9 teens at this time signed up to go to Nazarene Youth Conference next July. So we have about 11 months still to raise funds for our teens to go to Phoenix, Arizona for Nazarene Youth Conference. Our first fundraiser kind of kicks off today. We're doing an M&M sale. Now, you remember this. We did this last year for our trip to Peru. But this year we're going bigger and better. These are bigger tubes of M&Ms. We're still going to sell them to you for a dollar. And that's a bargain, because if you go to Walmart, they cost $1.48. I know, because I bought all that they had. So I bought them, and I'm going to sell them to you for a dollar. So I'm losing money trusting that our faith family is going to respond. Here's the beautiful thing. Each tube, once you eat your M&Ms, they melt in your mouth, not in your hands. Don't leave them in your car. Eat them first. Will hold 80 quarters. 80 quarters, if you do the math, is? I know it's early. Thank you. $20. All right. That's right. See there? $20. So $20 will fit in one tube. We have 75 tubes. If our church were to fill each tube, we will raise $1,500. That's enough money to send one of our teens to Nazarene Youth Conference in Phoenix, Arizona. So we're going to do this. Not, we're not going to do this every month, but this will be one time that we do this. So hopefully you'll find these for sale at the Welcome Center after church. $1, take them with you. We do hope that you don't have to fill them up. We hope that you will. And we're going to just trust that God will, you can keep this in your car. There's no timeline. You can keep it till next March. I don't care. Just put quarters in it, fill it back up, bring it back. Let's support our teenagers for this life-changing event. All right, it's great to be with you. I'm certainly glad that God is here. We have joined him in his house today. We're going to continue to worship him this morning by receiving our tithes and offering. We're going to ask our ushers if they'd please come forward at this time. Let's pray together. Father, just as we just sang, Father, Hosanna, God save us. We worship you now, Lord Jesus. Have your way among us. Lord, as this moment, as we pause or take time in our service to worship you by giving back to you, we thank you, God, for your faithfulness. You are so good to us, providing so much more than we need and many of the things that we want. Now, God, this is a chance for us to give back to you. Lord, it's with a joyful heart that we return to you what's already yours. Multiply it, God. Use it. Grow your kingdom. And God, I pray that you will teach us that we can never outgive our Heavenly Father who loves us so much. Father, we thank you for this chance to worship by giving back to you. In Jesus' name we pray.
Savior's love through the storm.
shall come with trumpet sound. Oh, may I then in him be found, dressed in his righteousness alone, faultless to stand before the throne. Christ
this morning to see Jesus.
I've tasted and seen of the sweetest of loves, where my heart becomes free and my shame is undone. Your
just stand before the Lord and sing it to him.
There's nothing worth more that will ever come close. Nothing can compare. You're our living hope. Your
fill this place.
I've tasted and seen of the sweetest of loves, when my heart becomes free and my shame is undone. Your presence.
Jesus, here and now.
Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Come flood this place and fill the atmosphere. Your glory, God, is what our hearts long for. To be overcome. experience the glory of your goodness. Let us become
by this morning. Get to be in his presence today. I know in this place, my heart was warmed as I saw a few of your faces, all of your faces, don't get me wrong, but a few of you here that have been on my heart, so I'm so glad to see that you've come to worship him today. I'm glad you're here. But you're not just here with one another, with each other, with your staff. You're here with God. So as we sing that chorus again, we're going to open up our altars. I just feel there's some heavy hearts today that just need to spend some time in his presence. You can do that from your pew, certainly, but there is something special about coming to an altar. We talked about that last week. It's a place where we bring our offerings, our sacrifices, all that we are and all that we're not, the broken pieces, our victories, our struggles, and we just give those things to him. So today, we're going to give you that opportunity. You can bring your praises, you can bring your burdens. Our God is here. Let's be overcome this morning by his presence. Spend some time with him today. Let's sing together and prepare our hearts for prayer.
Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Come flood this place and fill the
That's a bold prayer even of itself. To be in the presence of your glory, Father, really puts us in a vulnerable place. Because, Lord, in the presence of your glory, all those things that we are and all those things that we're not are revealed to us. Lord, it's in your presence, in the shining brightness of your glory, Lord, that reveals those things in our lives that don't belong. Those things, Lord, that we're grabbing and holding on to too tightly. Those things, Father, we're trying to control all by ourselves. And Father, right now, I just want to pray that we'll just prepare our hearts. Rend our hearts open before you. So that, Lord, as you speak to us, we're in the best posture, the best position to hear you, to recognize you, and to respond to you. What a tragedy, Lord, it would be to get up on a Sunday morning, Lord, to come into your house, to get dressed, Lord, to come early, to be here, and to not spend time with you. So, Lord, this morning, meet with us. I pray, Father, against those distractions right now, those things that are occupying our thoughts and our minds that are preventing us from focusing on you. Lord, would you do away with those things? I pray, God, for forgiven sin, unrepentant sin, Lord, those things that are preventing us from having a dialogue with you, those things that secretly, Lord, we're ashamed of, that we don't think anybody else knows about, but you do. God, I pray right now that that one who's lost, we would just surrender those things to you and open up their hearts and their minds, God, to hear from you today. I pray for one, Lord, that's weary, Lord, and brokenhearted, who just has trouble getting through the day. But somehow, Father, found the strength and the courage, the boldness to come here this morning. Meet with them right where they're at. Father, I pray for those that have come hungry and thirsty for more of your righteousness. Fill us, God. Fill them, Lord. I thank you, Father, for those that were able to be here today. I thank you, Lord, for Mary and for Rodney, God. We thank you, God, for touching Gary this week. It's a joy, Lord, to see Pam here this morning. And new faces, Lord. I pray, Father, whatever it is that brought them here, be it with a friend or whether they're just visiting or whether they're just in town, but Lord, they'll leave knowing that they were in the presence of our Most High God, our loving Heavenly Father. They'll know that there's something different at this church. It's not about people, but Lord, we acknowledge our flaws and our brokenness, and we surrender our way to you to give you the opportunity to speak and to move and to change us. Lord, we are all people you have changed. You've made a difference. And Lord, I pray this morning for that one who's just holding on. They'll be reminded, Father, of the faithfulness of old. How good you've been. And they'll hold on tight. We bring you the grieving. We bring you the affirmed. We bring you the lost. We bring you those, Lord, that are rejoicing, who have brought praises to you today. I bring you, Father, those who are waiting anxiously for answers or decisions that impact life, not just their lives, the lives of children or grandchildren. I pray, God, in the midst of the waiting, that you will continue to speak in a very profound and powerful way. Lord, the waiting's hard for us. We don't like to do it. But God, there's often messages, there's often truths for us to discover in those waiting moments. Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. We've come to worship you. And Lord, as we open up your word, may we receive it. May it be fresh and new to us. May it change and transform us. Father, we just rest in the presence of your glory. Show us what we need to see. Help us to leave this place different. And God, I just pray we will pass on to others what you have poured into us. God be the glory. In Jesus' name, we pray today. Amen.
Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Come love this place and fill the atmosphere. Your glory, God, is what our hearts long.
Aren't you glad to be in God's presence this morning? Regardless of what I say, I want you to hear from him this morning. I know that my mind's a little bit rattled and distracted today, so this is all going to be him, and we're thankful for that because it should always be him. But in these moments, I'm reminded more than ever that we are dependent, and we definitely need him to be involved and to speak to us today. We've been in the midst of a series, if you will, a season that goes all the way back to February that God's slowly been revealing and showing us what he wants us to look like. And we had a display up here over the last few weeks, a large picture frame with supplies of this picture God's creating through us, in us, that what's going to look like in His house, His heavenly mansion, if you will, of our church. Now, we all have family portraits in our houses somewhere or on your social media pages. We like to brag and show those things off. Well, I think God does too. He takes a lot of grit. He takes a lot of joy in those faith families that surrender themselves to His will and pursue the vision that He has for them. And we're in the process of trying to do that. And the first step of that was discovering the mission that He has for us. And you know that the mission we showed, or He has shown us through our church unique process, is that we are going to be a church that invites everyday people to discover the hope of Christ. That hope that each of us has already discovered. Hopefully that hope that each of us lives on a daily basis. That's our mission. That's our mandate. That's the thing that we can't help but to pursue. And when the word mandate adds a little bit of emphasis to that, that our mandatum, if you will, it's what we're compelled to do, to invite everyday people to discover the hope that you and I have already found. Now, in our picture frame, you see our frame, it has four sides to it. Our mission is one side. The other three sides are equally important. We're going to keep driving this idea home because we want you to learn this, to memorize this, to be able to talk about this in the checkout line at the grocery store if someone were to ask you, why are you so happy today? Well, let me tell you why. I've found hope in Christ, and this is what it all looks like. The other three sides are our strategy, which is our how we're going to get there. That's our map. Our measures, which we're going to get to later on in the month of July. And what we've been talking about for the last 4 weeks are values. What motivates us? Why do we do the things that we do? See, ultimately, this is what God has for us. Inside of this frame is going to be this picture of you and me. Smile, smile. See, Jesus wants you to smile in that picture. It's a beautiful picture. And it takes our struggles, it takes our brokenness, it takes our pain, it takes our victories, it takes our successes, it takes all those things in our lives that make us who we are, and we surrender them to God, and He shapes it into something we can never do on our own. Now we have four values. We get to the fourth one today. But the other three that we've talked about, we taught relating generationally, about having authentic relationships with one another, about being willing, if you will, to be transparent, to be vulnerable. Wednesday night in prayer gathering, we talked about happiness. One of the happiest countries in the world is Denmark. Who would have thought? Denmark's one of the most happiest nations in the world. The reason they find happiness, though, is in the simplicity of holding each other accountable within the family unit. See, when you hold one another accountable, there's no secrets. And you're less likely to disappoint. And if there is someone that does something wrong, you call them on and you change it. See, we've lost that, not just in our culture, but even within the church. We don't like to do that. So relating generationally means we love one another. We worship and we minister and we serve across all demographics. And we love each other to the point where we care if they're doing something that's not according to Scripture. We care if they start to wander. We care if they're missing in a church or a service. We care if they're not here to worship with us. We care when they're hurting. We then talked about growing intentionally. You have to choose to grow. You know that? We don't just grow on our own. We have to choose to grow. We grow intentionally. We make choices of how we're going to grow in our relationship with Christ. We believe that growing intentionally refers to wholeness in Christ, being made complete, requires continual commitment and devotion. That's what we want. We want wholeness. We want to be made complete. A disciple is someone who is always learning. There's never an end point in the discipleship process. You're always going to be learning and hopefully always growing. Last week we talked about serving purposely. Not just serving mindlessly, but serving purposely. Pursuing the heart that God instills within us. Knowing that God's love is what compels us to pour into the lives of others. That word compels is important. It means we can't help it. It's God's love being poured into us that we then have to pour out into others. And what that looks like is often going to be personal. It's often going to be corporate, but it has to always be purposeful. Now, in these values, there's dynamics that God uses to grow our faith. And inside these dynamics, we see our strategy reflected, gathering together, of growing intentionally, of going. We see all of these pieces start to make sense. See, these dynamics, when acted upon, show up in our involvement in the mission. All these things are important because ultimately this picture is to look like Christ's commission that He gives to us in Matthew chapter 28. To go into all the world, to make disciples. In order to make disciples, guess what? You first have to be a disciple. So we can't fulfill the commission until we first get ourselves in the right position. This is what this is all about. is creating disciples, making sure that you and I are in this process, this discipleship walk with him, so that we can be used to fulfill the commission that he's given to all Christian churches. That's what makes us unique. How we get there is what is important in this process, because once we figure that part out, the rest of it, I fully believe, church, happens naturally. It just happens. But we have to be in the right position first. Now, we've been introducing this process by having some our guest artists, if you will, over the last three Sundays. And I know a lot of you are very confused about what they're painting. And hopefully today it'll make a little bit more sense. I'm going to have Bob uncover all nine canvases, if you will. And as you're going to see this picture, I think it'll all make sense to you. You guys ready for the big reveal? We're like at a barnhouse reveal. Here it is. Aren't you impressed? Anybody want to buy it? It's for sale. I'm just kidding. So it's still a little bit mixed up. Still doesn't make sense. And that's what happens when we come together just as we are. We're all a little bit mixed up. Quit looking at the person next to you. We're all mixed up. We're all broken. We're all flawed. But in that, though, we all have an important piece of the picture that God's trying to create through us. We may be in the wrong spot. We might even be turned a little sideways. We might even be upside down. You guys are following me, right? This is all kind of figurative, but you're tracking with me here. But we're all part of the puzzle. We're all part of the picture. Now, to help you with this, we have some things we want to give you today. And our ushers are going to come and pass something out to you so you can kind of join in with what we're doing this morning. And you get to be a part of what's happening. See, because inside this picture, we're going to help, this is what's going to help us point other people to discover the hope of Christ. And as you are getting your puzzles today, Bob's going to help begin to make this puzzle make a little bit more sense. We want you to keep these, work on them, take them with you. We want you to share them. Perhaps you meet someone out and about in your community, in the neighborhood. Pass it on with them. Let them begin to see what this church is all about, how they too can discover hope in Christ. It's a lot of fun. It's one of those kid games you used to get have a lot of fun with. Some of you maybe get frustrated with and throw them away. Or if you're like my 10-year-old son who spent all day yesterday trying to figure this thing out, he finally just took it apart and put it back together the way that it should go. No taking it apart. And no just getting distracted during the sermon. I'm trusting you can multitask today, all right? You can work with your thumbs and you can listen at the same time. It's kind of like texting and walking, all right? Most of you are good at that. This will kind of put both of those things into practice this morning. What you have is a puzzle. Pieces that are out of order. That there's an intentional strategy and a plan and a pattern that we have to work out in order to put them back together. Same is true for the church. We come together as a puzzle. We're a little bit mixed up. But when we come into God's presence, he starts to put them back together in a way that makes sense. So finally, everything starts to, what was once fuzzy, what was once unclear, God helps us to focus. What God helps it to make sense, God helps it to look beautiful. But first, we have to release to God ourselves, our peace. And when we do that, he takes the messy, he takes the chaotic, he takes the out of order, and he helps it make sense. Is the picture starting to become more clear? Starting to make a little bit of sense? See, what we're all about has nothing to do with who we are as individuals, but yet who and what God does in and through us. If left to our own devices, left to our own strengths, then we probably wouldn't be here, but we know that there's something special about being in the house of God, about being in his presence, what Christ can do in our lives. And through that, through what he has done, through how faithful he has been, we have at some point in our lives found hope. Or perhaps you're searching for hope today, and that hope is what then drives and motivates us, and that's what we want others to discover. Hope in Jesus Christ. Now, when you saw our artists up here the last 3 weeks, could you have ever imagined this is what the end product would be? No. We're not that good. We're not that creative. We're not that talented. But when we leave it in God's hands, he makes it into something beautiful. Something that we should want to take and to pass on to others. Something that we should want others to know about. And then perhaps you're visiting with us today and you're thinking, what is this guy talking about? We are all lost. We'll get to the lost part in just a moment because that's our fourth value today. That's really what we're going to talk about and focus on. It matters. You matter. Your story matter. And God can take your mixed up, upside down scribbles and brush strokes, and he can turn it into something beautiful when we surrender it to him. All of us have circumstances or experiences in our lives, pivotal ones, if you will, our stories that God uses to shape us. God uses our circumstance. We're going to talk about more about that in July. But today, the value we're going to focus on, this is our fourth value, and probably our hardest. If we're really vulnerable, really transparent, really honest, this is our hardest. Our fourth value is this: we are going to be a church that has unconditional acceptance, that accepts unconditionally. Now, it's easy to say, much, much harder to do. Lost people matter to God, and therefore, they matter to us. Listen, I didn't say they should matter to us. They do matter to us. In the ministry we do, the way that we serve, how that we reach out, how we worship, what our services look like, they're going to reflect that as we continue to move into the future and reveal the layers of this mission for us. It has to. Now, there will be opportunities for intentional growth in our service. Don't get me wrong. We're not throwing everything out and starting up anew. Well, this is all going to be a process. We're going to develop these things together. But we have to care about lost people. And part of that, it begins with you. Going back to the very first word of our mission, inviting, welcoming, engaging in conversation, making sure that they know that we want them here. Now, this value, it's, when we went through the process, was given a word that at first I struggled with. But now I get it. I realize it. It's important. This is an aspirational value. It's a value we aspire to because we're not yet there. We're not yet there fully. We're making progress. And this is exciting to see. But what we want to aspire to accept people unconditionally. When I was, I won't tell you where, but at a previous ministry, we were at a church, and I think I've shared this perhaps before, but it just resonates with me. We had a young family come, and they had had a teenage son. And you know how the clothing styles are. I don't get it either, but you know how they wore their drawers down a little bit too low and showing off their boxer shorts. And we had a wise gentleman in our church go up to this young family, says, "Young man, we don't wear our pants like that around here." You know how many times they came back? None. I know that they did. I know you may or may not like that style. I get it. But that's not unconditional acceptance. They might have been searching for hope. They might have been hurting. They might have been dealing with a really tough experience or situation. And we basically just kicked them out the door because you didn't look like us. We don't do that here. I want us church to be known for what we're for more than what we're against. See, when we become known for what we're for, eventually those things that we're against or that God teaches us not to stand for, what takes us away from Him, those things will become clearer. But you never lead with that. You always lead with what you're for. We're for hope. We're for finding hope in Jesus Christ. We've got to figure some things out. This is aspirational because we have a lot of learning to do. I shared last week about a family that made an impact in my family's life in Mount Vernon, Ohio. And I shared about a young boy named Eddie and his siblings. And I won't give you a lot of details because I would never want to embarrass them. But when I first went to visit this family at their house, Pastor Cindy invited me to go with them to a home visit. We walk in, and there's a screen door, and there's no screen in the door. And it's because the kids had knocked it out. And you walk in the front door, and the kids are so excited to see us, they invited us right in. They're eating dinner with Cheetos and a sausage on a stick. And I'm just saying, this is supper. And then you walk in, and you see why, because their mother was on the couch passed out, and Dad wasn't home. And then God said to me, "How far are you willing to go, Brian?" Here's these grimy orange, you know, they make TV commercials now out of Cheeto dust. That was before my time. They're wrapping their legs around me. And I got my first taste of unconditional acceptance. Because I found these kids who needed to discover hope, needed to see what it looked like and what it was. We followed these kids for several years, and your mom eventually passed away because of substance abuse. Their dad was eventually passed away, largely due to some of the struggles that he had. And I'll be honest, there were some that wouldn't bring their children to the weeknight, Wednesday night bus ministry services because they didn't want their kids interacting with those kids. I get that as a parent, I do. But that's not what God did for me. I was a little scrawny little kid with red hair and goofy looking, and God loved me. God loved each of us. And I learned in a very painful and heartbreaking way that often the church while it should be the first to be accepting, sometimes is the last to be accepting. All of us are ingrained with this need for community, for this need for a place to belong. And if people can't find it here, they will find it somewhere else. But what do we tend to do about those types of communities? We'll complain about them. We'll look down upon them. We'll judge them. Rarely are we accepting and opening for them. It's hard. It's hard to do. That's why this is aspirational, something we're going to have to work on. A couple years ago at District Assembly, at NMI Convention, Loretta Yingling asked us to come and share about what God was doing in our Light and Darkness ministry. Some of you may be a part, remember that, you're a part of that, where we went into the local strip clubs and we ministered to the dancers. That was just unheard of. That was just shocking. It's still kind of shocking for people to talk about. And I remember sharing with the District Assembly that week that one of the clubs we went to downtown, it was women, if you're new and visiting with us, it wasn't the men who went in, but the women went in to minister to these ladies. It had a blue door, and I share with our district assembly and all of our delegates that Jesus still knocks on blue doors to strip clubs. If you read the New Testament, you read the Gospels, that's where you find him, eating with tax collectors and sinners and prostitutes. That's where you find him. That's where he goes. And yet we feel safe here, and we don't want that element to come in. Why not? We're incomplete without it. We're shallow and fake without it. And I think God wants us to grow intentionally in our discipleship journey, but part of that journey has to be chasing after lost people. Has to. Without it, we're incomplete. Without it, there's something missing. See, the truth is, we've all been lost at one point in our lives. You may not remember that moment, but we've all been in need of God's grace. One of the songs we just sang talked about the shame being removed from us. Praise the Lord, that's happened for many of us. But we've all been lost. Some of you may still be lost today. Many of us have been found. But found does not make us better. Ooh. Found does not make us better. It simply makes us found. And being found should change us. We're reading out of Luke chapter 15 this morning. And later on, I'm going to jump to 1 Corinthians chapter 13. So if you want to go ahead and mark that, you can. But Luke chapter 15, verses 1 and 2. We see now the tax collectors and sinners were all gathering around to hear him. Isn't that interesting? It was the lost that were drawn to Jesus. It was the lost that wanted to get close. They wanted to hear him, but the Pharisees and teachers of the law muttered, "This man welcomes sinners and eats with them." I like the word there, first word, verse 2, but. Here, who else gathered around him, but the Pharisees and teachers of the law. Now, let's don't take this too far, but understand the Pharisees and teachers of the law were the religious, were the faithful churchgoers. Now, there was something missing, and Jesus Christ is trying to reveal that to him, and I believe we found that something that's missing. So I'm not drawing an apples-to-apples correlation, but we've got to be careful, or we very easily could step into their shoes. The Pharisees and teachers of the law muttered, "This man welcomes sinners and eats with them." This man receives sinners. That's who Jesus is. That's why he came. He came to receive us just as we were or just as we are. Sinners, separated, destined to pay the ultimate price, death that comes from sin of being separated from God. So now Jesus sees this teaching opportunity. He sees these very diametric paradigm going on here. He sees people anxious to hear what he has to say, anxious for grace. And here's those that are more concerned about appearances. So he says, he tells them this parable, in verse 4. Suppose one of you has 100 sheep and loses one of them. Does he not leave the 99 in the open country and go after the lost sheep until he finds it? And then he finds it. When he's found it, he lays it on his shoulders, rejoicing. He comes home and he calls together his friends and his neighbors. He says to him, "Rejoice with me, for I found my sheep which was lost." Now, I would imagine some of his friends and family, perhaps like, you did what? You left 99 out and then you went and looked for one? What? But let's not miss what he's saying. When he comes home, he calls together his friends and neighbors, says to him, "Rejoice with me." Verse 5, when he found, he lays on his shoulders, rejoicing. This idea of rejoicing, inside of this word is this idea of joy. And joy in original Greek comes from the Greek word chara. Chara means grace. See, in the midst of rejoicing, there's this idea of grace. He's celebrating because grace has been received. Grace has been given. Once was lost, is now found. When's the last time we went looking for the lost? When's the last time we left those that are the 99 that we're comfortable with? When's the last time we reached out to the one who's been missing? Verse 7, I tell you that in the same way, there will be more joy in heaven over one sinner who repents than over 99 righteous persons who need no repentance. Don't you love coming into God's house and worshiping Him? I do. But sometimes I get sucked into this. Sometimes I enjoy the worship in His presence, but I also get caught up in maybe our self-righteousness. That God's pleased with who we are. He's pleased that we're here, pleased with what we've done, and He is. But let's not miss what the verse says. There will be more joy in heaven over the one who repents. There will be more joy in heaven over grace received. There will be more joy in heaven when the lost becomes found. That doesn't mean God doesn't rejoice when we come together and worship Him. He does. Because it says there's more than. It means there's still, because more than implies that there's already rejoicing there. But there's more joy, more rejoicing when the lost are found. Let's not get too comfortable with the lower level of rejoicing when God has more for us. We're incomplete, church, if we stop short of all that He has for us. Found sheep, I believe, become the best at searching for lost sheep. And we've got to remember, though, what it is we were saved from. How life looked when we were lost. When we forget that, we tend to not be as adamant, not be as passionate about what God's calling us to do. You maybe remember what your life was like before you found Jesus Christ? Do you remember what life felt like when you were lost in sin? Do you remember what it was like when you finally that light bulb came on and you realized, I'm a sinner separated from God? I believe today there's probably some among us that are struggling remembering what that was like. And I don't say God doesn't want us to live and dwell there. Don't get me wrong. But when we forget, it's so much easier to not care as much about others who are lost. We're to be motivated by the love of Christ. If you look all throughout the Gospels, you'll see Jesus time and time again responding to those who are lost. Those who culture would reject, those who others would turn away from, those who others would find a reason not to associate with. In Matthew chapter 8, Jesus touched the leper. In case you're wondering, He didn't touch lepers. Lepers were unclean. Jesus went and touched the unclean. In Matthew chapter 9, He called Matthew, a tax collector, to follow Him, to be a disciple, leave all that you know and come after Me. In the same chapter, we see many tax collectors and sinners gathering around to meet with Him. We see the Pharisees call them sinners. I mean, there was no secret. They just came right out and said it. This is who they are. What are you doing, Jesus? You're a teacher. You're not supposed to do this. And you're associating with these people that are untouchable. Matthew chapter 14, He ministers to the Canaanite woman. Luke chapter 7, he goes and talks about the centurion and his faith. Centurions were Romans. They weren't even Jews. What are you doing sharing grace with Romans? Luke chapter 19, Zacchaeus. Rumor has it he was a wee little man. But he was also the chief tax collector. Scripture, I think, puts that word in there for a reason. The chief tax collector. He was the tax collector of all tax collectors. The worst of the worst. Luke chapter 23, the thief on the cross. Even while he's hanging on the cross, Jesus is caring for the lost. John chapter 8, He talks to the adulterous woman, tells her to change and to go and sin no more. And in John chapter 4, the Samaritan woman at the well. Again, a Samaritan, if you will, in Jewish culture, a half-breed. He loves her, He accepts her, He calls her to a new life. John chapter 3, He even meets with the Pharisees who are willing to listen. He meets with Nicodemus. It's a conversation with Nicodemus that He shares the verse that we all know. For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in Him would not perish, but have everlasting life. All throughout the Gospels, Jesus is chasing after those who are lost. And that is what we, church, have to do if we're truly going to call ourselves disciples, followers of Him. Found sheep become the best at searching for lost sheep. And it's this idea of acceptance. That doesn't mean that we're going to draw a differentiating line here in a moment, because I think there's some that are probably a little bit confused. God loves us unconditionally. But God in Scripture does not accept unconditionally. But because we're not God, we're going to try to make things a little bit easier for us. We're going to bring them to God and let God do all the figuring out and the sorting and the speaking to. God loves unconditionally. But he doesn't accept unconditionally. He calls us to change. He wants us to receive grace, to have our hearts transformed. 1 Corinthians chapter 13, verses 1 through 3. Paul's writing, and if you read this love passage, if you will, there's three distinct sections. And when you divide up in the sections, you start to understand a little bit better. And what we see in the first part, verses 1 through 3, is this idea of what love isn't looking like. It's what it should look like, but it's not looking. It goes back to motivation, and the motives, remember, are our values. And Paul writes, if I speak in the tongues of men and of angels, but do not have love, I become a noisy gong or a clanging cymbal. In our culture today, there's too many gongs and too many cymbals playing much too loudly. And the world can't hear the church. The world can't hear what real love looks like. See, if I don't have love when I'm speaking to people, if I don't have love when we're having real conversations about things that make us different, then I'm nothing more than just noise. If I have the gift of prophecy and know all mysteries and all knowledge, meaning if I can see into the future and if I know how it all works together and I'm really intelligent, and if I have all faith just to remove mountains, but I don't have love, Paul writes, I'm nothing. I mean, I can have all this stuff that will make me successful in this world, but if I don't have love, I'm nothing. Verse 3, if I give all my possessions to feed the poor, if I surrender my body to be burned but do not have love, it profits me nothing. Too many confuse service with relationship. Service is a part of relationship, but apart from love, it profits you nothing. You may give up yourself, you may give up your time, but if you're not doing it out of the right motivation, there's nothing to be gained by it. See, this idea of unconditional love versus unconditional acceptance is a fuzzy one. And to be honest, as I was working on this message, you'll be glad to know it probably should have been three messages, maybe even four. You'll be glad to know I've cut those other two out, so you're going to get out of here before 2 o'clock today. And because when you start really looking and digging into this, it just, God's word takes you so far and it's so broad. But it's important for us to remember what we're really trying to see here is who God wants us to be. If we're his disciples following after him, trying to be who he has created us to be, then he becomes our measure. He becomes our model. He becomes the one that helps us realize and recognize and strive to be who he's called us to be. It's not easy to get there. It's hard to get there. But God's very clear in his word of what it's to look like and how we're to act and how we're to treat people, how we're not to treat people. If you look at the second part of 1 Corinthians chapter 13, now we see from God's perspective what it's supposed to look like. Love is patient. Right off the bat, he throws in one of the hardest ones, doesn't he? Love is patient. Sometimes that's the hardest thing for us to be. Love is kind. Kind. Love is not jealous. Meaning we don't care what others have or what we don't have. Love is not jealous. Love does not brag and is not arrogant. Love does not act unbecomingly. It does not seek its own. It's not provoked. Love does not take into account a wrong suffered. Woo-hoo. No keeping score. Love does not rejoice in unrighteousness, but rejoices with the truth. Love bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things. Love endures all things. That's what love is. Is that what love looks like in your life? This is kind of a personal one. If you look at verse 6, though, it's important that we don't miss this. It states that love does not rejoice in iniquity. Now that word iniquity, kind of speaking to transgressions, to wrong. It's speaking to those things of sin. Love does not rejoice in iniquity. Love does not rejoice in unrighteousness. Love does not take pleasure in sin. sin. See, we do accept unconditionally, but we recognize through God's love that while we're accepting, we're not rejoicing in the sin that we're accepting. We're not accepting that. God loves the sinner but hates the sin. We've heard that. And it's the church sometimes, though, I think, has taken it upon themselves too often to make sure that we know what that means for people to understand that when we hate the sin, this means you can't do this anymore. And in the process, we forget where we've been. We forget what it means to be lost. We forget that it wasn't a single person or a church person that saved you, but it was God who saved you. His grace that saved you. It was the recognition of what Jesus did that saved you. There's no convincing or argument. It's the Holy Spirit coming. If the Holy Spirit's not in it and not moving and not convicting, there's no salvation to be had. All this stuff works together. We don't rejoice in those things. God calls sin bondage. So why would we rejoice in someone else's bondage? Why would we rejoice in someone else's chains? See, that's what, when we accept without love, then that's what begins to happen. And church, that goes all the way back to relating generationally, having authentic relationships. If we have relationships that aren't authentic, without holding one another accountable, that's that we begin very, very subtly, but it does happen. We begin to rejoice in iniquity. We begin to rejoice in unrighteousness. And it becomes normal. I think it breaks God's heart, and it should break ours. I was at the store yesterday and saw something weird I hadn't seen before. It was a Muslim woman dressed from head to toe, and you could only see her eyes. And my first was like, whoa, I hadn't seen that here before. But my second response was to pray. And I prayed for her. I don't know her. I don't know where they're visiting. I don't know, but I prayed for her. There's probably been times in my life where that wouldn't have been my first response. But I need to care for those that are lost that don't know him, Jesus yet. I need to make sure that I'm not celebrating in iniquity. And when I don't get involved in someone else's state of being lost, what am I saying? I'm either saying it's okay, or I'm saying they're not as good as me. They're not as righteous as I am. There might be some other answers there. But when we're not moved by someone being out of relationship with God, when it doesn't break our hearts, that then I think that there's something that's going on inside of us that we need the Holy Spirit to come and take care of. We can't dismiss the truth of Scripture, not just the parts that condemn sin, but the part that tells us as the church that we're to love and to reflect that, the love that God has poured into us. We can't pick and choose. We have to be who God has modeled for us to be. Not always easy, but it's something that he desires for us. If you keep reading in 1 Corinthians, if you pick up verse 7, love always protects. Love always trusts. Love always hopes. It always perseveres. Verse 8, love never fails. Anyone ever failed you? Let you down? Yeah, we're human. It happens. But when we live a life of love, all of a sudden those happenings become less and less. Let's keep reading, though. There's something else I want us to catch in this passage. There's that word again, but. But if there are gifts of prophecy, they'll be done away. If there are tongues, they will cease. If there is knowledge, it will be done away. For we know in part and we prophesy in part. When the perfect comes, the partial will be done away. When I was a child, I used to speak like a child and think like a child, reason like a child. When I became a man, I did away with childish things. For now we see in a mirror dimly. If you go back to the Greek, it says we see in the mirror a riddle. We see in the mirror a puzzle. But then face to face, now I know in part, but then I will know fully just as I've been fully known. Let's put all that together. But that's a beautiful thing here that God wants us to not miss. When I was a child, I talked like a child. I thought like a child. I read like a child. When I became a man, I put a childish ways behind me. Now we see but a poor reflection in a mirror, this dim picture, this puzzle that on its own doesn't make any sense. When I became a man, when I grew up in my faith, when I grew as a disciple, I put these puzzles and these childish ways behind me. And I let go, and I let God rearrange them and put them together in the shape of a picture that makes sense. Church, I mean this with all the love that I can muster, and I'm speaking to myself because it really spoke to me this week. There's some things in our spiritual journeys we need to change, and we need to grow up. Lost people matter to God, and they should matter to us. I need to grow up and care about those that aren't in a relationship with Him. Not because they have, oh boy, they've missed three Sundays in a row, and oh man, that's going to really hurt our numbers, our end of the year reporting, oh, what are we going to do? That stuff matters because those numbers do tell a story, don't get me wrong. But our motivation should be, what's going on in their life? Are they hurting? Are they dealing with something? What's going on? Why are they apart from the family? Being together, gathering together is an important value that we share. What's going on that they haven't wanted to come or been able to come? What can we do differently? Sunday school classes, when's the last time you went down your roll and picked out who's been missing? Why have they been missing? Maybe they found someplace else to worship, and then if they have and God's blessing that, then we're going to honor that. But maybe they just haven't felt like they belonged. We have a family in our church in the last year that's left because they feel like they didn't belong. They didn't dress like everybody else, didn't act like everybody else. It broke my heart. I don't want to embarrass them and tell you who they are, but we all can look around and see faces that we don't see anymore. Be reminded of those who are missing. This should matter to us. It should matter to us. We need to put childish ways behind us. We want God to show us not a poor reflection, but a clearer image of what He has for us. Now I know in part, then I shall know fully. Don't you want to be known fully? Don't you want to know fully? And last part, even as I am fully known. I want our community, our world to know who we are completely. Who we are, who we're not. What we're about, what we're not about. Where we're going to strive to be better, what we're trying to fix and change, what we're trying to do differently, all so that others could discover hope in Christ. It's an aspirational value. This whole idea of unconditional, that's a tough one. But I think we can get there. We have to be okay that people may come and not be like us. Not just okay with it, but excited that they're not like us. We have to realize that they don't have to become like us to be found. We have to realize that they don't have to first get everything to where it looks just like we do and act like we do and talk like we do before they can be saved. That's not a condition God gives in His Word. See, well, they just have to believe. We have to share the hope, and it's in the believing that God draws them and speaks to them and convicts them. Let's be known for what we're for, church, and not what we're against. See, this requires, I wanted to end with this because I think it's important, and I love the song that we sang earlier because it's it just fits. We can't fulfill this value on our own. And I love that we are a church of the Nazarene, a holiness church that believes in the indwelling of the Holy Spirit, the empowering of the Spirit, because that's what's needed to love unconditionally. Because in our humanness, we can't. Not for very long. But when God comes and He pours His Spirit upon us through holiness and a discipleship journey that is real, as we pursue His picture, then our pictures, our personal, our corporate pictures start to come together, and all of a sudden we can be all that He is calling us to be. Not just half of it. Complete. Fulfilled. Can love like Jesus loved. For some today, you're still holding tightly to your brush. And you know your piece is a mess, but you just can't let go. You got to give up the brush. For others, you got this picture, and you're just not willing to be turned or to be put in the right position. You're completely upside down and you know it. But boy, to surrender and to let give up that control. Others are like, well, Pastor, I really want to be this piece over here, but I look more like this piece and I don't want that. Let go. Let go. Because we're always going to fall short. There's always going to be something missing. We're always going to be left wanting. If we can't love like Jesus loved, if we can't care for the lost the way that Jesus did, and we're really not going to be, this is a part for me that I'll be honest with you, I haven't invited anybody to the church several weeks. And I want God to convict me of that. I'm not happy about that. And I want to see people in my community and not judge them by what they're doing or not doing. I want to look at them the way that God looks at them. I want us to be a church that invites. In one of our last meetings, as our most recent meeting, our vision team, we were setting goals. We shared those goals with the board this past month, and many of our goals are measurable, they're attainable. There was one goal that was thrown out there, and Pastor John says, you know, I really think we need to set an attendance goal. And not in like a Sunday school drive or an Easter attendance type thing, but a goal that would really show that we're inviting. And I struggled with that. Because, you know what, if you don't put a number to it, then you're not really accountable to it. But we want to, by the end of our next fiscal year, next June, be running 220 in our worship services. Now, so far in June, we've run about 165, 170, but last year we averaged 187. It's summertime. I get all that comes with summer. I don't like it, but I get it. And that's about a 25% increase. That's only going to happen when we live out the mission and invite. When we accept unconditionally, when we grow intentionally, when we gather together. So now I like it. I'm not going to lose sleep over it, don't get me wrong. But I like that we have something that we're pursuing. Because inside that number are people, lost sheep, people that are wandering, people that have just lost track, that need to be reminded that they're loved and welcome here. Let that be our motivation. The Holy Spirit be what guides us. And as we pursue His picture, let's let go of our brushes and learn to love like Jesus. We're going to have a time of prayer today. And there's some people on my heart that I'm going to pray for. Maybe there's someone God's putting on your heart that you just need to come and give to them. Ask the Lord for an opportunity, an ordained encounter, if you will, to share, to invite, to encourage them that God loves them. Maybe you are holding too tightly to your brush and you just want to come and release it today. Beautiful place to do it at the altar. Maybe you've got a picture you just need to let God have control of. Maybe you have a family member, a child, a parent that doesn't know who Christ is. They're lost. You just want to commit them this morning to Him. We're going to open up our altars and give you that chance. Church, either this matters to us or it doesn't. At the end of the day, if lost people don't matter, then that's going to speak volumes to our world this morning. I invite you to stand with me. And as Pastor John sings, I'm going to pray and just invite you to come. We're going to pray for those that are lost, and then we're just going to worship together. But I hope you'll leave today motivated to do something. Make a phone call, write a letter, send a text, take someone to lunch, quit doing what we've been doing because some things need to change. It begins this morning with us. Let's pray together. Father, Lord, would you move our hearts today? Would you break our hearts, Father, for the things that break yours? Lord, I just pray right now for those that have been found, those that are in relationship with you, those, Father, that are walking this discipleship journey, that God, you would put someone, a specific person, a name on their heart at this moment. And that, Lord, our first thoughts would not be of judgment, Lord, but we would be compelled to just to love them, to be there for them. They might not look like us. They might not talk like us. They might not do the same things that we do. But Lord, they're a child of the King. And that, Lord, you model for us in this parable what we're to do. We're to leave those that we're comfortable with to go out and find the one that's lost. God, would you help us to step out of what's comfortable to be who it is you're calling us to be? Right now, Lord, I think of those ones you've put on my heart. God, help me to quit being a bystander. Quit waiting on someone else to step in and do what it is you've called me to do. Quit waiting on someone else to be the one who gives an invitation. God, too many excuses. Too many times, Lord, we've just thought someone else would take care of it and do it. We are all someone else to someone else. Lord, there's too much at stake. Not just the souls of those that are lost, Lord, but I believe if we're not engaged in this part, this value, this part of being a disciple of you, Lord, then we're incomplete. And Lord, as long as we're incomplete, we give Satan an inroads, a path, Lord, of distraction, of complacency, of becoming too comfortable. And God, I feel that there's churches all across our land, across this world, they're just too comfortable today. And Lord, comfort kills churches in time. So Father, shake us up. Help us to be who you want us to be. May it begin with a simple invitation. Maybe it's coffee or lunch. Maybe it's just a walk at the park. Maybe it's a ball game or a picnic. But Lord, I pray we would be intentional. I pray, Father, that our spirits would not be that of judgment or rejection. That Lord, we would strive and aspire to be people who accept all that you would send to us. We would love them, Lord, as you love them. Now, Lord, we would create opportunity for your spirit to speak, for your grace to transform. Because God, I want to be part of the rejoicing that heaven experiences. I pray for those that are here this morning that are lost, that don't know you, or that have wandered from you. But Lord, know a lot about religion, about the Bible, but have not yet made that decision to surrender themselves to you. For too long, God, they've danced around you, and today, Lord, they have the opportunity to dance with you. If there's unforgiven sin, Father, I pray that that person would ask for forgiveness right now. If there's a lack of compassion that needs to change, I ask, Lord, that we would surrender that right now. Lord, if there's someone holding too tightly to their brush, not wanting to give up control, wanting to be something different than what they are, but yet aren't willing to accept who it is you called them to be, then Lord, I pray that you would just continue to speak and to minister to them. Break them, Lord, to the point where they have to depend upon you. Because God, as all of us is true individually, it's also true corporately. We become more complete when we as individuals allow you to put us in the right place. Father, we love you today. We need you today. And I pray, God, as we leave this place, we'll be inspired and motivated and encouraged to invite everyday people to discover hope in Christ. Remind us, God, of the hope that we have in you. May that be what motivates us to pour into others. Lord, we love you this morning. Go with us, Lord, as we leave this place. Change us. May we be different than how we've come. It's in Jesus' name we pray and ask all of these things today. Amen. God bless you today. As you go, go with purpose and intention. Go inviting. Go sharing the hope that you have found. God bless you.